Okay, hello. My name is Mohammed Ali, and I'm a software engineer. And today I'm going to be talking to you all about lightning fast self documenting APIs. In the talk today, we'll mainly focus on two things: HTTP2 and GRPC. We'll go through what is HTTP2, its advantages, and how it's related to GRPC. What are the types and the advantages of GRPC? And then we'll have a simple walkthrough of how to build a simple GRPC service. And then to conclude the presentation, we'll have a simple demo of GRPC in a polyglot architecture. So over here, we've got two images. Each of them consists of 200 blocks of images that are put together in order to clearly show the difference in response times between HTTP 1 and HTTP 2. So the first image uses HTTP 1 to request for these 200 smaller images, and the second one uses HTTP 2. So as it's evident, HTTP 2 response time is less than 50% of what HTTP 1 gives us. So what really is this sorcery called HTTP 2? So it's a newer version of HTTP after HTTP 1.1, which is super ancient because it was released in 1997. So it's based off of another open specification network protocol designed by Google called Speedy. So Speedy was then deprecated in favor of HTTP 2. Speedy was built with the primary focus on improving security and providing and reducing latency. So HTTP 2, these are the real goals of HTTP 2: to reduce latency, to improve security, and provide overall performance optimizations. In order to maintain consistency, it maintains the same core semantics as HTTP 1. So it's got the same HTTP methods, status codes, header field names, etc. When we're integrating HTTP 2 with client applications, because of the faster response times and the robustness, it results in a much better UX and the client applications responding in a much more reactive and faster manner. So what makes HTTP 2 so great? What is it that it brings to the table? So let's go through the advantages of it. It's fully multiplexed, so it can handle multiple requests and response at the same point in time, which is a big win over HTTP 1. Because the browser imposes something called head-of-line blocking, which limits the maximum number of parallel requests that the browser can make. So that means if my endpoint is blazing fast, and if there are other requests in the pipeline, I'm going to be blocked until they are completed. So overall, to the user, it appears like my website is super slow because of this blocking. So this is something that HTTP 2 overcomes. The next thing is binary. So the transfer of data and the passing of data is much faster since it's binary. It's less error prone and it's much more efficient as compared to HTTP since it's textual rather than binary. Another really important thing is there's a lot of bloatware in HTTP 1. The headers are really huge. You don't need that much as much bloatware as there is in HTTP 1. So the way HTTP 2 combats this problem is using HPAC instead of deflate, which is normally used by HTTP 1 and even Speedy. The other interesting thing is that deflate is vulnerable to crime attacks. So a hacker can hijack your sessions and get your access details and then do whatever he wants from there on. So HPAC basically addresses two things: compression of headers and it's resistant to crime attacks. Headers are compressed using static dictionaries, dynamic dictionaries, and Huffman encoding. The next thing is server push. So the server is actually able to proactively push resources to the client rather than the client requesting first and then getting data. Another really interesting thing that HTTP 2 provides us is bidirectional streaming. So you no longer need to make multiple HTTP 1 requests or add those extra headers for every resource that we want. We can just open up a stream and there's a free flow of data from the client and the server. So how is this related to GRPC? GRPC is built on top of HTTP 2, so it leverages all of the benefits of it. If you want to implement GRPC, we need to use HTTP 2 as the communication protocol. So what is GRPC? I mean, I didn't name it, but it's a recursive acronym. So it's GRPC is GRPC remote procedure calls. I'm sorry, I didn't name it. So anyway, the meaning of G changes in every release. So the latest release is 1.22, and the meaning of G here is Gale. Before that, it was Gandalf, and before that, Godric. So I think they watch a lot of movies, but again, I didn't name it. So now that we know what GRPC is, right? What's an RPC? It's basically an invocation of a procedure or method from the client to perform a particular task on the server. But the interesting thing over here is that the client requests or calls this method as if it was a local method. So it results in really clean and easy dev. So then what's GRPC, right? It's just an open source RPC framework developed by Google. Why is it better? It's built on top of HTTP2. It leverages all of the benefits of it and much more. It's based on protocol buffers, okay? So it's going to use protocol buffers as the interface definition language, as well as to structure your message payloads. And it's designed with speed and efficiency in mind. So obviously that's what it brings to the table. So let's go through some of the advantages of gRPC and why we should be looking towards gRPC rather than REST. So it's multi-language and cross-platform. Cross-platform, available in multiple languages, Java, Golang, Node.js, Python, you name it, you got it. But, and the interesting thing, right, is now we're not restricted by tech anymore, the kind of stack I'm coming from. If I want to build quality backends, I can do it in whichever language that I want. Protocol buffers, right? They're language neutral, strongly typed. I mean, I've had various discussions and confusions about what the API accepts, what's the response format, is this the correct data type, should I expect an array or should I expect an object? All of this is gone, right? The documentation is the API clients, and the API clients are generated in a single command line. And the interesting thing is, you can't just call it using some string, right? You need the API clients to be able to interact with your server. So it's self-documenting and it's lightning fast. So even with all of this that it brings to the table, right, it's also extremely efficient and performant on the wire. The serialization and deserialization time is faster even than XML or JSON. The message sizes are even more reduced, and the client and server compute time is also reduced. Great support. I mean, I don't know what I'd even do without Stack Overflow, man. So gRPC's got a really active and large community, and they're always there helping people and supporting everybody. The next thing is DevEx and easy setup. Single line installation, super straightforward, nothing fancy. It does what it promises. So it reduces all of the frustration or the overhead that we face when we normally try to experiment with new technology. The setup is literally like 15 minutes to 20 minutes and you're good to go. So in order to leverage the true potential of gRPC, we need to understand what type of RPCs that gRPC provides. The different type of RPCs are unary, client streaming, server streaming, and bidirectional. So let's go through each of them and the use cases in which we can actually use these RPCs. So here we've got an Android client that has some sort of authentication, right? So it's gonna pass in encrypted credentials, and the server's gonna respond with some access token and the time till it's valid, or an error. Single request, single response. Let's say another example of this would be, I wanna get education details of a particular employee based on the employee number. So single request, single response, ideal use cases. The next is client streaming, and this is where it sort of starts getting really interesting, because now your client can send a continuous stream of messages and the server will respond with a single message once it's done. So where can we use this? Let's say I want to stream some sort of analytics data. This is I have an iOS client or a mobile phone, and I need to stream my analytics data about user flows, what the user wants to do, what he's clicking. All of this can be streamed. Assuming I have some sort of map based or routing application, right? Then I can stream the GPS data. But all of this is one off, right? Something a bit more generic, file uploads, right? We can break the file into continuous packets and keep streaming that. And all of this is really compressed, right? Because we no longer need to have any overheads. ECTP2 as a protocol itself is super thin, so it makes everything much more streamlined and faster. The next type is server streaming RPCs. I'm sure all of the people here have faced this problem where we need to display a list or a table of data, and the ECTP1 way of doing this is using a paginated endpoint. So let's say your page size is 100, right? And you're getting 100 items at a time. That means in order to display even the first item, I need 99 other items to be fetched. In terms of like a user experience, that results into something really bad, because the user is going to be greeted with a loading screen, and it doesn't give an enriching performance, an enriching experience. But over here, you create your stream, and now the server is going to start sending you messages one at a time. So almost the instant you reach on that page, you've made the request, and you'll at least get one message back. So you start displaying, and in no time you get third and the fourth, right? And whatever the user can see on his mobile is already covered, and he doesn't need to care about what's being done below. But as he scrolls, he'll get to see more data. So another use case of this, another type of RPC is bidirectional RPCs. So this is where it gets even more interesting, right? Because now you've got like two live entities who can continuously communicate with each other. The client and server are no longer just things that make one REST call and then wait for a response and something later on. It's continuous communication between the two. So syncing events between services, or even a simple chat application. Even more interestingly, let's talk about like audio streaming or audio calls, video streaming, video calls. All of this requires bidirectional streaming, and this is the perfect use case for it. So now that we have all of this data about what gRPC is and HTTP2 and its advantages, why not we go through how to build a simple service in gRPC? So the most important thing is defining your protofile. So as explained earlier, right, the protofile is going to be the IDL as well as it's going to define the structure of the payload. So let's go here, and I have my protofile.
Can you
increase
the font?
Yeah, sure. Okay. Is it visible, or should I make it a bit more? 22? 24. Apologies. Yeah? Are you visible? Okay. So, message movie. So over here, in my demo, I've got a movie library. So my server consists of, has a library of movies segregated by genres. So, the movie message is here, and it's got four attributes. So let's go back here. So you need to define the type of message you want to send. The type of message basically dictates the structure of the payload that can be communicated between the client and server. So it needs to be structured such that it is efficient enough to communicate everything that's required in a single message between the client and server. The other thing is that the tags should not be overridden when writing new features in order to maintain backward and forward compatibility between the two. So let's say I want to add another rating feature to my movie message, right? So how do I do it? Just in 64, rating equal to 5. And that's it. It's ready to be used. So for now, let's cancel it back. So the next part is designing your APIs. So actually, this is the most important thing that we can do while building a gRPC service: designing and writing your protocol buffers. Because we can't override our existing structure. Once you've written something, you got to live with it. So we need to be able to carefully craft our protocol buffers. What would consist of a well-written protocol buffer? A well-written protocol buffer would be one in which the RPC is standalone and independent of other RPCs, and each of your RPC can perform one well-defined task. That's it. So this is, again, let's go back to the protofile. I've got a service that's called a movie library. It has two RPCs, a bidirectional RPC and a server-side streaming. So the bidirectional RPC basically allows the client to get and update the movie library, so it can list the movies in the library, and it can also publish new messages and update the library. And list movies is just server-side streaming. So let's say I'm a client that's interested in some genre. I can just list the movies of that genre, and whenever new movies are added to that genre, I will get updated with those as well. So the next part is building, is generating your server client stubs using the protocol buffer compiler. So it's really simple. So this is all generated code. It's visible, right? Yeah. So let's say I just delete this. So I use Gradle as the build automation tool here. So single line, and that's it. It's generated already. Everything that's needed just from one proto file. How does Gradle do this? So your build.gradle will have a generate task, generate proto tasks, which in turn calls proto C, which is the protocol buffer compiler, and it's going to generate all of this code and give it to you for free. So let's talk a bit more about polyglot architectures, right? So let's say I've got a Python client and I want to distribute this API client to him. How do I do it? It's really simple, single line. So this basically looks for, if you see over here, the Python out, client slash Python client. So let's go there. Okay, let's delete it. So single line, and that's it. It's generated. This same client will be used over here in movie underscore pb2 and movie underscore pb2 GRPC. So it will contain both your client server stubs as well as all of the request builders required to facilitate communication between the two. So moving on to the fourth and most important part is the service file, the service that we create, movie library, is gonna generate a base implementation. In your service, you wanna extend that, and then you can override all of the individual methods or the RPCs and put your business logic over there, and that's it. You're ready to go to business. So the next part is the demo where we are gonna discuss GRPC in a polyglot microservice architecture. So first let's cover what's polyglot, right? It basically speaks or knows different languages. So let's consider an ecosystem where I've got multiple microservice ecosystem, and each of my microservices are written in different languages. And this is actually a problem that I've faced as well, because in my current company, NinjaVan, we've got Java with Play, Java using Play framework microservices. Most of our microservices are using Play framework. And we wanted to experiment some stuff with Golang. So we actually had to spend about 10 man days just building API clients all over again, and so that we could communicate with the rest of the ecosystem. And I feel like that's quite a bit of a restriction from allowing us to try and experiment new tech, because we've already got scale, right? And you want to experiment with new stuff at scale. So, I mean, at least for me, that's really important. So this sort of solves that problem, because as you saw, single command line will generate your API clients. It's well documented, because all of the documentation that you add in your proto, right, is going to be included in the API clients that you export to the other services as well. So it's a win-win. So let's go to the demo. So let me explain a bit more. So there's a Java server that has the movie library. To start off with, it has a list, it has a few genres and some movies in each genre. There's a Java client, Node.js client, and Python client. Each of them will initially subscribe to some genres that they're interested in, right? And once they start up, they'll start receiving messages about those genres, or they'll receive movies about those genres. Now, in order for them to update, they'll just add a movie and the genre, and it'll update the list. And all of the clients who have previously subscribed to that genre will get server pushes regarding the new movies. So let's get right to it. I cheated a bit because I wrote scripts to build everything. But yeah. So my script's done, and I'm gonna run it. So, all right. So this right here is my server. This is my Java client, my Node client, and my Python client. My Node client subscribes only to horror movies. He's a bit of a freak. My Python client subscribes to Action and Thrillers. He's cool. And Java's just greedy. He subscribes to everything. So let's say that I want to, let's say the Python client wants to publish a message to a horror movie. He's interested. So let's say he goes to the ring. Sorry, I made a mistake. So the movie, okay, I'll do that again. So the genre is horror and the movie is The Ring. So over here, it's published, genre horror, it's case insensitive. I mean, we wrote it to be case insensitive for now. So it's published to whichever clients are listening. And similarly, if I want to publish a new genre, let's say I'm interested in comedy. So I say comedy and I say Meet the Spartans. So that message isn't published to anybody because they're not interested. But now let's say a new client is interested in comedy. So we want to give him some more context, or we want to deliver what we've previously had here. So this is where the list movies request comes into play. So assuming that my Python client is also interested in comedy, and he enters some movie called Horror Movie 1, and that's it. He'll receive both Meet the Spartans as well as Horror Movie. So all of this, right, it's possible by using GRPC in a polyglot architecture where all of these microservices are able to talk to each other without really having to go through all of the overhead of writing API clients, of going through tons of documentation. It's just calling a simple method like you'd call any other method from another class in your local file system. So yeah, essentially that's it from me. These are the key takeaways or the key points that I've covered today. And I'll be really happy to answer any questions that you guys have. Thank you.